Kerry Passo, Boxing Fanaticos, this is the end of the do another boxing analysis. This analysis is between Jermall Charlo versus Hugo the Boss Santana. Now, let's get straight to it, my people. I see Jermall Charlo, just to be honest, washing Hugo Santana and blowing him out of the water. I mean, he's in his prime right now. I don't see anybody beating him at this point, not even at 160. Maybe his only arch rival besides Triple G is Demetrius Andre. And if you guys know anything about Demetrius Andre, he is a dog in there. He's no joke. He's nothing to be played with. You feel me? So I would have to say him definitely. I'm trying to think. Hugo the Boss Santana does have a good style though. And he does throw very good combinations. When he wants to, sometimes he can be a one trick pony, just throwing one punch at a time, but he's very versatile. He can go southpaw, he can go orthodox. And then when you can do both, you're very special. And he does it in a very good way. I just feel like Charlo with that style, you know, is take his time style and he just boom, just lands the right hand, just boom with the 1-2. He's very basic, but he's very fundamental, but powerful. I mean, he has this crazy power for the weight division. And I know he walks around what I walk around at least 175. Cause I'm a big dude. I'm 6'1". It has it on listed that he's 6 foot. I believe he's about 5'11", but he's a strong 5'11" for the weight class. Hugo the Boss Santana is about my height. He's about 6'1", 6'2". And the dude can punch. You know, he has some highlight knockouts. Some really big highlight knockouts that you guys should check out if you haven't seen it already on YouTube. You got Jermall Charlo representing Houston, Texas. You got, you know, Hugo the Boss Santana. You know, he comes from a very, very, very hard background in Oxnard, California. Growing up around, you know, La Colonia with all the gangs and a lot of thug life shit. You know, he's seen some shit, but he's just very humble about it. He doesn't really speak on it and everything. And he's a tough dude, and he sparred with everybody from the likes of Sergio Maravilla Martinez, which is one of my favorite fighters of all fucking time. If anybody that knows me, I used to make Sergio Martinez videos about 8 years ago, back in 2010, 11, and 12. He actually is one of the reasons why I got paid from YouTube, is because a lot of his analysis that I used to do. So big shout out to Sergio Maravilla Martinez, first ballot Hall of Famer all day. Now, getting back to the topic at hand, you know, this Saturday is for the vacant WBC interim middleweight championship title. A lot of people don't know what interim means. I believe it's like the second tier to the actual title. You know, so many different sanctioning bodies and organizations. You know, I don't try to keep up with all that shit. But I will say this. I see Hugo the Boss Santana. He needs these three keys to victory if he's going to win. Use your height. You have a 75.5-inch reach advantage, so you actually have longer arms than Charlo. Use those longer arms in the first round. Set the tone. Control his front. Control Charlo early and make him have to think about every little thing he does. Don't let him come in the inside of you. Control the distance. Box side-to-side movement. Let me say it again. Side-to-side movement. That's number two. First, box with intelligence. Take your time. Use your jab. Two, side-to-side. Three, keep your guard up at all times. Try parrying. If you can't parry, then use your legs. You know, fight in spots and fight when you want to fight. Don't fight when he wants you to fight. That's a big key. If he can, if I see that Charlo can dictate and do what he wants to do and be the boss, be the bully in there, then that's what's going to happen. I see Charlo dominating if he cannot set the tone with those three things. So it's very, very important. Now, Jermall Charlo, be Jermall Charlo. Put the pressure on. Use your jab. You have a very distinctive, hard, especially Jermall. Jermall has that hard, stinging jab, man. Like, his jab is nasty. So, if he lands that jab with authority, how I know he can set the tone, set the pace of the fight, push Hugo Santana back. He don't like fighting backwards that much. So, push him to the ropes and let your hands go. Because most people can't fighting backwards. It's very few. Sergio Martinez could. Edwin Valero could. Floyd Mayweather could. Miguel Cotto knew how to do it. And it's a few people, but not too many. They're not their best going back. He was 90-9 as an amateur. Hugo the Boss Santana was. So he's no fluke out here. He's a real veteran. I know he's only 27. He's my age. But, you know, the guy has so much that he's still bringing to the table. You feel me? And he's 26 wins with 14 knockouts. So he's around the, you know, over 50% knockout ratio range, which is not bad. And like I said, he has the power to hurt Charlo. If he hits Charlo with that right hook in the southpaw stance, or he hits him with that big straight left hand and he lands it clean on the chin or right here in the temple. Remember, this area, soft tissue, right where the brain is. You get hit here, you get hit here, right in the back. Yes, back there, or you get hit here, or of course right here. It's all nerve. I can just feel it right here. It's just nerves, crazy amount of nerves, and nerves right here on this area. You get hit in those areas, you're going to get knocked the fuck out. So it's very important for Santana to pinpoint his shots. Be precise. Pinpoint your shots. Accuracy matters. Control matters. Pinpoint accuracy. That's what he needs. And if he can do that, if he can control his opponent, use effective aggression, and he can, you know, be the ring general in there. Because that's what I score the five categories, which is effective aggression. That's just what I score first. Boxing skill, meaning you're controlling your opponent with your boxing skill. Number three, defense. You're using your defense, your hand-eye coordination, your reflexes to get out of the way, evade, slip, or parry punches, block punches, if you're doing it effectively. Number four, throwing combinations. I know people don't score that, but I have it, throwing combinations. And number five, ring generalship, which is the most important. He who controls his opponent is the victor at the end of the night. That's just how it goes 9 times out of 10. Unless you get hit with a punch you don't see, that's how it goes. So, and I usually score jabs too, but that's not part of the 5-point category. But I do score jabbing. If you can control your opponent with your jab, if you're throwing 30 jabs and you're landing 20 jabs per round, you're doing something special. And usually you can land combinations. More than likely at this professional high elite level, you're going to be throwing beautiful combinations off of that beautiful jab that you just keep landing. You just keep pumping in his face, hitting him with the stab jab to the body. Another key to victory for both. He who controls with body punching controls this fight. Put water in the basement. Put money in the bank. Save for a rainy day. And that's going to the body. You go to the body effectively, you can dominate each opponent. I believe so. Because both of them haven't had, you know, where they're getting hit consistently to the body with a sustained body attack. So, like I said, you guys tell me what you think in the comment section below. Don't forget to like, rate, comment, and subscribe. I feel like Charlo has had a lot of craziness going on with the beef with Broner and Javante. I discussed this in my other video, and I really feel that they shouldn't be fighting. Y'all two black men, man. You know what I'm saying? Y'all black, bro. You got to stick together. You feel me? But beef is beef, and I feel like it can affect the focus of the fight. But then at the same time, Charlo is a guy that is just a fucking savage. You feel what I'm saying? That's why he calls himself Lions Only. You know, I'm a Leo. You know what I'm saying? I'm a July birthday guy. So I get what he's saying about being dominant and being strong and being in control, you know. And that's how he, you know, presents himself. So until I see otherwise, I'm going to think that he's going to be on point. I have Jamal Charlo either winning by a quick knockout because he catches him with something he don't see, which that is very possible. Second or third round after he fills him out, he's going to start dropping those bombs. Now, what Santana does to counteract that is what's going to make this fight special. So I will be paying close attention into that. And he who dominates and controls the pace of the fight will win. And I think if it goes the distance and Santana does this thing and he's actually jabbing, he's turning and frustrating Charlo, he either get a late round stoppage, or if it goes the distance, he can get a unanimous decision win because he's that talented. Because he has sparred with the Triple G's, the Kelly Pavlis, the Dave Benavidez, everybody. So he has the experience. Now, when it comes to Charlo just needs to be Charlo. Land that big punch. Put you know, Santana on wobbly legs and get his ass out of there. Let your hands go. Let them combinations go. Either get the TKO or knock him out with a big right hand. Throw that right uppercut. You have a beautiful right uppercut. I want to see more check left hooks. If you don't throw the check left hook, just put your punches together. That's all you have to do and you'll get the knockout. So third round knockout is what I'm going with as my analysis. I feel like I said, he's going to take his time. set the tone with his jab, set the pace with his jab, and just show him that it's lions only. I'm dominating this motherfucker. This is about me. It's not about you. And get Santana out of there. So, you guys tell me what you think in the comment section below. I will get back to you more boxing news, analysis, and updates. Peace. And don't forget to hit that bell icon to your right-hand side of the screen.